Jean Charest, welcome to NBC5 In Depth. Here we are, Independence Day in the States, Canada Day in Canada, and it's still essentially closed to all non-essential travel. I'll tell you, there is a lot of confusion here about that. We hear, well, we're waiting for 75% first dose vaccinations, and then more recently, maybe 75% fully vaccinated, which could take a long time. Are you clear on Canada's policy?
Well, right now it's in flux. And then part of it, you know, Stuart, is we can all understand. I mean, from the day the border was closed and it was agreed between both countries that we would act together in sync and do month by month decisions to avoid locking ourselves into just a closing of the border. Now, there's been first wave, second, third, and then variants. And so that's what has played on the decisions of the government. What's interesting and what you should, you know, to know is that at the outset, opening the border was very unpopular with Canadians, very, very unpopular. The election of a new administration made it a bit easier because they felt it was, and then the American side, frankly, really got their act together and demonstrated that you were on top of things. And now I'm guessing, I didn't see recent polling, Stuart, but I'm guessing that a majority of Canadians want the border to open. And the vaccinations is what's changing public opinion and the view of the government. So I'm anticipating that on the 21st of July, we'll probably see a partial reopening of the border for people who are completely vaccinated, means two vaccinations, tested before, maybe tested on arrival, and no demand for quarantines, so that they can, you know, move around pretty freely once they've crossed over to the Canadian side. That's where I think things are at right now. And if the rules as we speak on this day is that a Canadian coming into Canada, a Canadian on the 6th of July, not as of now, will be able to come in if he or she is fully vaccinated, tested before, tested when they arrive, and then if it's negative, they won't have to quarantine. That's the rules as they apply now.
What effect do you think a unilateral decision by President Biden to allow Canadians south over the border, opening the land border with Canada, might have? You know, there are some in Vermont hospitality that think that would be a very good idea.
If it happened, I think Canadians would understand, Stuart. I mean, both governments are drawing on the experience of 9/11, by the way, which happened over 20 years ago, and there was a unilateral decision from the United States. And it really did create a lot of difficulty because merchandise didn't move between the countries. Now merchandise is moving. The sector that is terribly suffering is the tourism, hospitality sector. States like the state of Vermont, New Hampshire, Northern New York are really taking a hit. So at this point, frankly, if the American side decided to move ahead and open up, I think there's a lot of majority Canadians would probably say this is a good decision, and it would put pressure on the Canadian government to act accordingly. I mean, if you're doubly vaccinated Canadian coming in and it's okay, why would it not be true for an American? I mean, it's the same pandemic and the same treatment, frankly. So I think we're probably going to move that rapidly enough in that direction, and the American pressure is going to have a lot of impact on the Trudeau government.
The latest public opinion poll that I saw in Canada showed there is now just barely majority support for reopening the border to those who are fully vaccinated. But as you point out, there was a lot of opposition until very recently. Yeah. And I'm wondering, do you think that the Canadian government sort of fomented that fear to get Canadians to comply with curfews and that sort of thing?
Stuart, there's no doubt, to be very honest, Canadians' governments reacted to populist sentiment in regards to the pandemic. There are a lot of Canadians were offended that other Canadians would travel to go south to Florida during the wintertime. And so part of the measures that we've seen are dissuasive measures. For example, quarantining for 14 days is not absolutely necessary. It could have been 7 days. And then the rules as they apply now, by the way, is if you do come in, and this will stand until the 6th of July, not only do you have to quarantine, but you have to go to a government-appointed hotel for 3 days while you await your test to see whether it's positive or negative to your own cost. And this costs on average $2,000. So why is this done? It was done to discourage people from traveling. And it's not scientifically based. It's more because we want to, and that you can understand why partly they would do that. But at this point, no, not anymore. Not if we're, because people are asking this question, Stuart. Why, what's the point of getting vaccinated if it's going to remain closed? We got vaccinated so that we could return to some semblance of normal life. And a normal life for a Canadian is to be able to travel to Vermont. If you live in Quebec, as I do, I come from Southern Quebec all my life. We've traveled regularly to Vermont. We love Vermonters. We love our neighbors. We're very lucky to be neighbors. Frankly, we think we won the lottery. And so we got vaccinated because we want to be able to travel to Vermont and see our friends.
Do you think the pandemic has changed our habits or it will spring right back to where we were a couple of years ago?
Well, you're asking a very, very important question, and that's part of the risk. After missing two summer seasons, if you own a house on one side or the other, you are asking yourself whether you're going to continue to own that house, whether you want to run that risk, or you've spent two summer seasons not going to that restaurant you used to go to, and where you know the owner and the people who work there. That is the risk, and that's why this is time sensitive. And we want people to be able to travel. There used to be, before the pandemic, 400,000 people a day who move between both sides of the border. There's no other place in the world where you see this, Frank. You're asking the question. We need to move before people start, just changing their habits, because it's the border, rather than being a place where you transit through, is an immovable obstacle. And that's more of a reason for us to get moving on this and allow people to travel.
Let me ask you a couple of political questions. You are one of the best known political figures in Canada. You served both in the federal government and, of course, had a long run as premier of Quebec. I remember your visit to Burlington when the New England governors and the Eastern Canadian premiers would get together each summer. I'm wondering, going forward, what do you think the issues are going to be between Eastern Canada and New England, Northern New York?
Well, there's always a few key issues. One of them is going to be the Buy America policies in the United States, which for us has always been a perennial issue. The Biden administration has tightened up the policy. And we think it makes more sense for us to have a Buy North America policy, because our businesses are integrated. And the supply chains are integrated. For example, the aerospace industry is important in Vermont. It's very important in Quebec. There are supply chains between both countries. It makes more sense for us to look at the world together and to eliminate as many obstacles as possible between both our countries to be able to prosper economically. But the biggest threat would be, I'd say the short-term threat would be that. And then as we look to the future of the border, for example, the big question, Stuart, is what is it going to take in the future to cross the border? Are we going to be demanding that people prove that they're vaccinated or tested? This may be permanent. That part of it, I think we're going to have to think through. I'm anticipating, you want my opinion, I think in the future, coming into Canada, Canadian government is probably going to require that you demonstrate that you've been vaccinated and completely vaccinated for COVID-19. And if that's permanent, how do we organize it to make that as seamless as possible, to be able to make that, to prove that you have been and be able to access the country?
Last question. There's that other big event here in the States in recent months. How do you think most Canadians view the change in the U.S. administration?
They view it positively. I want to be careful here, because we're very respectful of the choice that Americans make for their leaders. And what's interesting in our relationship is that Canadians and Americans understand there's the political leaders and there's us, our families, our friends, our neighbors. And no matter who's in office, that doesn't affect the basic relationship we have. Now, Mr. Trump, by his personality for Canadians, was something that was foreign to them. Canadians are very reserved, quiet. And Mr. Trump wasn't exactly our cup of tea. You know how to identify a Canadian in Vermont, by the way. It's the person at the ATM machine who, when he gets the money, says thank you to the machine. You know, that's a Canadian. And so the Biden administration is viewed much more favorably because Mr. Biden's style is very different. But on the policy side, you know, the Biden administration has policies that are as tough on Canada as some of Mr. Trump. So it's a better relationship. But in the end, again, Stuart, you'll never find Canadians complaining about who you decide to have as the president or not. That's your business, and we respect that. But what really counts, though, is all the friends we have on the other side of the border. That's the relationship that we treasure and want to preserve.
Well, we can't wait to see you again. Jean Charest, the former Premier of Quebec and Deputy Prime Minister of Canada, it's been our pleasure. Thank you for being with us here on NBC5 In Depth.
Thank you, Stuart. Bye-bye.